WYFF News 4, live local breaking news at 6.
First tonight, stormy weather.
We'll check out the damage in just a bit, but first, there he is, Chief Meteorologist John Sesseris. John, the worst is over, right?
Yeah, absolutely. We could still see a few isolated to scattered thundershowers develop as we go through this evening, since we still have some pretty deep moisture on top of us. And a little piece of energy coming in from the west could trigger that thundershower, producing lots of lightning, very heavy rain, and some gusty winds. But this is what it looked like yesterday afternoon. And look at these thunderstorms move off to the northeast at up to 30 miles per hour. And some of these thunderstorms were very strong, very electrical thunderstorms, lots of lightning, damaging winds, and also some large hail associated with these thunderstorms as they raced off to the east and northeast at up to 30 miles per hour. Here's a look at some of the wind damage and hail reported across the western Carolinas and northeastern Georgia. And outside right now, that whole system has shifted off to the east and basically right along the I-77 corridor between Columbia and Charlotte. Nasty thunderstorms there, but they are moving away from us, and that is certainly good news. Now back to you, Carol.
Thank you, John. It was a near-death experience for an elderly couple last night after a tree toppled into their home and trapped them inside. News 4's Kim Quintero is live and local in Greenville County. Kim, what an absolute mess, and not from a tornado either.
No, that's right. Believe it or not, all of this damage was caused from straight line winds blowing about 60 to 70 miles per hour. They snapped these trees like a couple of pencils, virtually demolishing this home and the one right next to it last night. We're on Highland Avenue. The good news is everyone in these homes walked out without a scratch.
A little overwhelming, isn't it, Mom?
On the porch of her daughter's Greenville County home, Lillian Alexander is full of emotion.
I love you too.
It was just hours earlier that she and her husband were trapped in the rubble that for 50 years was once a place they called home.
We ain't got nothing left, but we're still blessed.
Thursday night, a violent thunderstorm swept through her neighborhood.
We heard this roaring sound and a big boom, and my husband jumped up and said, "Oh, we got to get out of here." So he grabbed my arm and got me on through there, and we just stood right in the back of the house.
A weak tree was no match for the storm's 60 to 70 mile per hour winds.
And glass shattered everywhere, and then by the time that window blew out, the whole house just caved in, all but that little place where we was at.
In a matter of moments, firefighters responded and pulled the couple out.
It happened so fast, I guess I was just kind of in shock.
Through the chaos, no injuries, leaving the Alexanders embracing what they deem as a miracle.
Thank you, Jesus. That's all I know. Thank you, good Lord.
Now, Lillian Alexander and her husband obviously can't stay in this mess, so their insurance company is putting them up in a motel tonight and the next couple of days. Then eventually they'll be moved into a permanent residence. Kim Quintero, WYFF News 4, live in Greenville County.
What a scene. Thank you, Kim. A woman and her boyfriend face charges tonight in crimes against 18-month-old twins. Stephanie Blake is in the Spartanburg County Jail, charged with two counts of child neglect. Deputies say her boyfriend is Randall Matheny. He is charged with one count of criminal sexual conduct and two counts of child neglect. According to the sheriff's office, the crime involves an 18-month-old twin girl. The incident report states a medical exam found the baby girl had a number of bruises on her body and a deep vaginal tear. The sheriff's office also tells us the twin girl's brother is in the ICU with bleeding between his skull and brain. The child weighs only 18 pounds and has bruises all over his body, as well as rashes in his pelvic area and a laceration on his bottom.
In the city of Pickens, some people are torn tonight over the resignation of Police Chief Tommy Ellenberg. He stepped down last night, as we told you here on News 4, after admitting he used a racial slur over a year ago. News 4's Keisha Foster joins us live and local. She's on the story from our Anderson newsroom tonight. Keisha, good evening.
Good evening, Michael. Tommy Ellenberg quit one day after returning to work following a 15-day suspension. He was reprimanded for using the N-word in regards to two city council members, and the opinions on this matter are mixed.
I was disappointed that it happened. I thought that we were through it.
Support for Tommy Ellenberg can be seen around downtown Pickens. There are people who wanted him to remain.
He made a mistake, and it was a big mistake. You can't really use that word.
Those who pushed to get him removed.
Apologizing was not enough. That just really wasn't enough.
And folks who believe in restoration.
Police chiefs sit on a higher pedestal, but I do believe everybody deserves a second chance insofar as he gets educated on what that, how horrible that word is.
Yes, is have it, and we have accepted Chief Ellenberg's resignation.
Thursday night, in a 3-2 vote, Pickens City Council accepted Ellenberg's resignation. The change was effective immediately. The council agreed to continue paying for his insurance for 8 months at a cost of about $400 a month, and he'll get $13,000 for his remaining vacation and sick time.
We live in a society where everybody makes mistakes, and you know, for somebody going to lose their job over, you know, one word. I mean, this is a major word, don't get me wrong. But for somebody to lose their job, you know, making one mistake, I just don't believe that.
And we attempted to reach out to Tommy Ellenberg at his home, but there was no answer, and he doesn't have a phone number listed. Keisha Foster, WYFF News 4, live in the Anderson newsroom.
Keisha, thank you. Four people were on board that plane that crashed in western North Carolina this week, and tonight we know their names. Sky 4 was over the crash site near the town of Unaka. This is Cherokee County, North Carolina. It all happened Wednesday night. The plane was headed to Hazard, Kentucky from Atlanta when it went down. There are no survivors. 27-year-old Matthew Shuey was the pilot. His passengers, 23-year-old Tiffany Maggard, 22-year-old Casey Lynn Robinson, and 20-year-old Miranda Morgan. All four were from Kentucky.
Spartanburg Regional says someone stole a computer containing patient information. According to a hospital spokesman, the computer was stolen from an employee's car on March 28th. The computer contained a password-protected file with social security numbers, names, addresses, dates of birth, and medical billing codes. The vice president sent out a letter today to those who may be affected by that data breach. Here is part of that letter. Quote, "We have no reason to believe that any information has been misused. We have reported this to the proper authorities, and an investigation is ongoing. We have also taken steps to enhance our security procedures." End quote. The hospital is also offering free credit protection for 1 year to those who may have been affected. For the sixth year in a row, the USA Pro Cycling Championship is rolling through Greenville. But this year, the event comes on the heels of a 60 Minutes report that linked a Greenville cycling star to performance-enhancing drugs. News 4's John Eby has the story.
Greenville native George Hincappy is used to being the center of attention when he comes to race in his hometown. But this time the spotlight is shining on him for an issue he doesn't want to talk about.
George, I have to ask, last week your name came up in conjunction with that 60 Minutes report.
The report cited unnamed sources that said Hincappy told a grand jury that he used a performance-enhancing drug. So far, he's refused to address whether the report was true.
Well, it's definitely, you know, something that has been on my mind, but you know, I like to focus on the good things in my life, and I have a lot of those things.
With the USA Pro Cycling Championship about to start in Greenville, businesses downtown are focusing on the good things too.
It doesn't diminish my excitement at all.
The manager at Carolina Triathlon on Main Street says the bike shop sees an annual bump in sales when the race comes to town.
I'd say within a month after the race, we'll see an uptick in sales, which is nice, but it's a lot about the interest that's generated, where people are coming in and asking questions about something that they have no knowledge of.
Even shops that have nothing to do with cycling are gearing up for the thousands of people that come downtown for the race. Postcards from Paris, an interior design store that's normally closed on Mondays, will be open to cash in on the flood of cycling fans.
It is absolutely wonderful. We see people from all over, not just here locally. We do see a lot of local people as well, but people from all over the country. It's amazing.
Hoping that when the race is over, Greenville comes out a winner.
Time trials for the Pro Cycling Championship start tomorrow at 11:30 at the CU ICAR Center. The road race itself starts Monday at 11 in the morning on Main Street.
Downtown Greenville is, of course, home to plenty of shops, restaurants, and soon a place you won't find anyplace else in the upstate. All new at 6 tonight. News 4's Gabrielle Komorowski on where people can sample liquor and some lessons about Greenville County history.
From the walls colored the color of copper to these oak barrels, many of the things here are meant to look old. But the Dark Corner Distillery on North Main Street in downtown Greenville is so new, it's not even open to the public yet.
9 out of 10 people in Greenville we speak to have no idea where the Dark Corner is at or even have ever even heard the term Dark Corner.
Joe Fenton, who was raised in Landrum, named the micro distillery after the part of Greenville County he calls home, an area known for a certain type of drink.
Dark Corner was, I guess, the moonshine capital of Greenville County.
He, business partner Richard Winger, and a third partner want to shed some light on the Dark Corner.
This is, of course, where all the magic happens.
Here they will make South Carolina's first legal moonshine.
We haven't had a legal distillery in Greenville County since Prohibition.
The distilling process is meant to be authentic and unique. The distillery owners actually designed this copper still, and they had it made just the way they wanted it.
We're going to use local ingredients, with local recipes, and we're going to hand make it.
Visitors will be able to sample the moonshine and purchase a bottle while taking a swig of some local history.
We're not doing this to, just to make money off of moonshine. We really want people to walk in the door and get hit in the face with a dose of upcountry lore.
Gabrielle Komorowski, WYFF News 4, Greenville.
Another day, another rain out for John on the road. John was supposed to be on the road in downtown Greenville tonight for the Greenville Scottish Games Parade. The parade was canceled due to the rain, but the Saturday events are still scheduled. The Scottish Games are at Furman. Gates open at 8 in the morning. The opening ceremony is at 11. Plenty of games and entertainment for the family all day long. A Celtic jam concert will close out the night from 8 until 11. For more information, go to WYFF4.com. We've put a link to their website there. Just look in the Memorial Day event story right there on the front page.
Now your live Super Doppler 4 HD weather forecast.
And the showers and thundershowers that we had during the day today are lined up right along the I-77 corridor. Very electrical thundershowers, and these are actually developed into thunderstorms, and they were quite strong earlier. No warnings right now. From Columbia I-77 all the way up to Charlotte, it's been off and on heavy-duty thunderstorms this afternoon through this evening. Pretty quiet through the western Carolinas and northeastern Georgia. We have a little piece of energy coming in the upper atmosphere later on this evening, and we still have some pretty deep moisture, and with partly sunny skies outside across most of the area, fairly unstable. So we could see a pop-up shower or thundershower, very electrical, not expecting anything strong or severe, but we could see a thundershower develop just about anywhere as we go between now and midnight tonight. And if that thundershower does develop, maybe some pea-sized hail, some gusty winds, below severe limits though, but very electrical and extremely heavy rainfall, so we'll keep you updated. Look at all these thunderstorms right along Interstate 77, and the potential for widespread severe weather will be farther to the east. We had a cluster of some very heavy thundershowers developed and moved right through McCormick County, Abbeville, Greenwood, parts of Lawrence, Newberry, Union counties, all the way over into Chester County and York County, and now we have more heavy-duty thunderstorms just north of Columbia. Look how electrical these thunderstorms are. A lot of lightning. And then, of course, if you're traveling for the holiday weekend, if you're heading east, you're going to bump into these heavy thunderstorms, as you can see. Between Charlotte and Fayetteville, they had some very heavy thunderstorms all afternoon long in the Raleigh-Durham area. Now they're just looking at rain showers, but it's causing some problems for the ACC baseball, and I'm sure Mark will probably talk more about that in just a second. At least hope so. I'm sure he will. And then there's those thunderstorms now, just showers. Flash flood warning still continues for the Raleigh area, though. And now if you're heading south beyond Interstate 26 between Columbia and Charleston, you're also going to have to deal with some ponding of water on the roadways because some heavy thunderstorms there, heavy thunderstorms right along Interstate 95. But the beaches are in pretty good shape. And if you're going to the Carolina beaches this holiday weekend, you'll probably be in pretty good shape. Partly sunny skies, probably start off with some patchy fog and maybe an isolated afternoon or evening thunderstorm, very typical of summertime in the deep south, and especially along the beaches. And of course, this is the unofficial first weekend of summer. It's what we call it, the Memorial Day weekend. Look at severe thunderstorm watch still continues to our east, and that's until 7 o'clock this evening. Temperatures look like this, cooler with the cloud cover to our east. Milder temperatures the farther west you go because we had more sunshine. Highs were in the 70s today. How about rainfall amounts? This is yesterday evening and yesterday afternoon and today. So total storm systems, almost an inch and a half in Greenwood, over an inch and a half in Spartanburg, almost 1 inch of rain in Greenville. Good soaking rain, 63 hundredths in Anderson, and almost 3/4 of an inch of rain at the Asheville Airport. Watch boxes all the way up and through New England. Cooler temperatures behind the front. Right now it's 55 in Chicago. Tomorrow we'll start off with morning clouds, some patchy fog. Then that front, the warm front's going to lift off to the north. The clouds will start to break up. Partly sunny skies, slight chance of a stray shower or thundershower for the mountains tomorrow afternoon. And the warming trend to start, 56 for the overnight low in the mountains tonight, 64 in the upstate. Just that isolated shower or thundershower developing this evening. Morning cloudiness giving way to partly sunny skies in the afternoon. Warmer high 84 tomorrow, near 90 on Sunday, and then around 90 on Memorial Day. We'll keep it dry and hot for most of next week, except for the mountains. They'll see a few scattered showers or thunderstorms in the afternoon or evening over the holiday weekend.
Not bad.
No. Overall, not bad.
Feel like it warm. Yeah.